Captain Midnight.
This video is brought to you by Skillshare and features spoilers for Season 1 of The Witcher. Okay, so I'm going to make you a promise right now. I'm not going to spend any of this video comparing The Witcher to Game of Thrones. Now, I hate to start this video about the show complaining about the coverage around the series, but I gotta say, I don't think The Witcher has really got a fair shake. In literature alone, fantasy is a massive genre, and the last 15 years or so has seen some really great novels. From Joe Abercrombie's awesome First Law series, to Scott Lynch's really fun heist novel, The Lies of Locke Lamora. And that's barely scratching the surface, not even mentioning other mediums like video games. So why does it feel like whenever a high fantasy film or TV show comes out, it's like pigeonholed into only being compared to Game of Thrones or Lord of the Rings? Now, I'm not saying that you need to be an expert of the genre to review something, because I don't believe that. But when reading, like, the Entertainment Weekly review of The Witcher, I was really struck by just how dismissive of fantasy that a lot of critics just seem to be, acting like it's not even worth engaging with at all. I mention this because while I don't think The Witcher is a perfect show, I really do admire it. It does a lot of things well, and to me, what it doesn't nail, I can forgive because it's telling such an ambitious story. One that spans decades and kingdoms, but more importantly, one that always puts its characters' journeys and growth at the forefront. So to ring in the 2020s, it just feels right to finally get to talk about the show that inspired my first video that really got any traction at all on YouTube all the way back in early 2017. While not everything I was optimistic about back then panned out, I'm very happy to say that Netflix's Witcher was exactly the show I hoped it could be. Going into the show, all eyes seemed to be on Henry Cavill, and seeing if he'd be able to balance expectations from both game and novel fans. And I'd say he did a really great job, but honestly, I wasn't really shocked. Like, I expected Cavill to be a good Geralt after hearing about how obsessed he was with the character. Really, it was Anya Shalhatra's Yennefer that really caught me by surprise. Now, when she was first cast, I was a little skeptical. She seemed just too young to be Yennefer, even the one found in the short stories of the first book, let alone the game set much later. But I'm really glad to be proven wrong here, because not only is she great in scenes with Cavill, really nailing Yennefer's confident, stubborn personality, going back to her childhood turned out to be a great move too, and that was probably my biggest surprise of the season. What I love about Yennefer's story is that in many ways, it's a cynical spin on the Harry Potter-style hero's journey. Mocked by her peers and hated by her family just because of a physical deformity, Yennefer is whisked away by a powerful institution and taught magic, eventually getting to remake herself as she sees fit and becoming a powerful mage. And that's the kind of wish fulfillment that's kind of a cornerstone of the fantasy genre. But in the universe of The Witcher, happiness does not come easily. Learning from these mages is far from Hogwarts. It's a brutal organization. One that, in one of the show's most disturbing scenes, disposes of a bunch of young women who they've decided aren't really of any use to them by literally stripping them of their humanity and using them to generate power. And even when Yennefer really stands out as one of the most talented ones in the group and is able to reshape her body, it doesn't really make her feel any more fulfilled. One of the most interesting relationships in the show turned out to be Yennefer and her mentor, Tessia. It evolved and changed throughout the season, starting out with Yen in kind of fearful awe of her, to hate, to something approaching mutual respect. It felt really natural, and I think it's a great example of how the show always kept its eyes on character development, even when telling this massive, continent-spanning story. I want to talk about Geralt more, but before I get into it, I feel like I need to address one of the most unique things about the show. Its structure. I was nervous going into The Witcher because I'm often not a big fan of the way that Netflix structures its seasons of television. So many showrunners love to say that their show is more like a 10-hour movie, not just some TV show. And honestly, I kind of hate this tendency. Episodic shouldn't be a dirty word. I get that especially these days, most viewers don't want the Law and Order structure, where almost nothing the characters went through carries over to the next episode. I really don't want that either. But approaching things like a 10-hour movie isn't the best solution. Just look at countless Netflix shows like season 1 of Jessica Jones, a detective show so allergic to the idea of the Case of the Week episode that it stretched its story across 13 episodes, starting well and ending okay, but moving almost nothing forward in the middle of the season and having to come up with all sorts of embarrassing plot contrivances just to keep this story going. A Buffy-like mixture of weekly stories with season-long arcs really avoids this, and maybe even more importantly, those smaller stories can really help build out a world and make a show feel like it's filled with interesting supporting characters. Which, especially thanks to the games, is something the Witcher franchise is kind of known for. Thankfully, The Witcher show seems to understand this, and instead of going with just a 10-hour movie laser-focused on one plot, it created a pretty unique structure. Sure, Ciri and to a lesser degree Yennefer have very serialized season stories, but with Geralt, the show wasn't afraid of doing some really great one-off monster hunting, most of them based on short stories from The Last Witch. There were a couple of real highlights here. In Betrayer Moon, Geralt battles Astriga. And I gotta say, I think they really nailed the look of the monster here. The battle is pretty much exactly what I wanted from a Witcher show, filled with over-the-top gore, magic, and some well-placed deadpan lines. But in true Witcher fashion, it's not really the Striga that provides the real horror of the episode. It's the petty and gross actions of the people themselves. So sure, it maybe wasn't the most surprising story, but it presented the ideal template of a Witcher episode. But I think my favorite episode turned out to be the 6th, Rare Species. This one sees Geralt and the gang trek up a mountain in search of a dragon. And look, are the dragon effects a little bit shaky? Sure. But I can easily forgive that for how the episode blends a really solid episodic story filled with memorable new characters with ongoing story arcs. I liked Yen and Geralt finding some comfort in each other only to say some genuinely hurtful things that tear them apart again. And of course, that moment where Geralt yells at Jaskier to leave him alone. A surprisingly effective and sad moment in what had been kind of the one purely comedic element of the show. In my video from 2017, I pretty stupidly said that Witchers were stripped of all emotion, and even though many on the continent seem to believe that's the case, it's pretty clear that this just isn't true. And Henry Cavill does a great job at conveying all the conflict, anger, and hurt that's boiling just under the surface of Geralt. The Bard, Roach, and Yennefer are all really important in getting that across too. Because as gruff as he wants to act about everything, it's clear that those few connections he has are really, really important to him. The show also does a great job at conveying his very specific sense of morality. Sometimes brutal and often unsentimental, but almost always just. There's a great scene in the 4th episode where Geralt says that there is no destiny. It's just something people tell themselves to apply order to an orderless and random universe. And while he may believe that, I think one of the interesting things about Geralt is how in his travels, he almost always does try to find some sense of order, some way to navigate the jobs he takes where he doesn't have to settle for the lesser evil. Something like that might be easy in the world of, like, Narnia, but is pretty hard to find here. And I think that's part of the reason I like the character so much. He may be a really deadpan asshole at times, someone who can chop off limbs without a second thought if he has to, but at the end of the day, he's the closest thing to honorable that the universe of this show really has. He's straightforwardly honest and fair in a world that usually isn't.
No, that's not me. Where's the scar?
It's definitely you. Really captured you. Sure, Avalok's only interested in you for your magic abilities.
Very funny.
Speaking of Ciri, you've probably noticed that I haven't brought her up too much so far. And I guess there's a reason for that. I think her storyline was the most predictable and basic of the three. The actress did a good job, but a princess learns the world outside her castle is a lot harsher than she thought and she has to fend for herself is kind of what I expected going in, and it's exactly what I got. I did really like how the show jumped around in the timeline though. Now, I've seen a lot of people online call it too confusing, but I actually really enjoyed piecing together where the three storylines were in relation to each other. And the ending where it brought them all together wasn't exactly shocking, but it did make me really excited for season 2. If I had one big complaint, I think it's that the season could have used a few more episodes. They tried to tackle so much in season 1, and for the most part, I think they did a good job. But I would have loved to have more time with the Nilfgaardian characters, who really only got a few scenes, as well as seeing more of Yen's time as a mage in the king's court. We kinda just skip from her getting the job to her being really dissatisfied with it. And that worked, but I would have liked an episode where it really hit her that the life of a mage isn't all that she hoped it would be. Still, those problems are pretty minor for me in the grand scheme of things. Overall, The Witcher is what I really wanted it to be all the way back when it was announced in 2017. It's exciting, funny, sad, and filled with smart character development. And even though a lot of critics may not have clicked with it in season 1, something tells me that this is a show we'll eventually look back on as one of the fantasy TV greats. It embraces almost everything that makes its source material beloved, while smartly translating it into a new medium. But you know, I'm sure you also have plenty of opinions on The Witcher, and probably a lot of other TV shows and movies too. And if you're looking for a way to get those out into the world and jump into the content creator game, I think I have the thing for you. How to make a podcast, plan, record, and launch with success on Skillshare. Taught by a pro podcast producer, this thing dives right into everything you need to know about launching a podcast, covering pretty much all the bases you'll need to get started. And that's just the tip of the iceberg of what you'll find on Skillshare. It's a new decade, so why not start fresh by learning some skills that could open up whole new doors? Whether you're looking to learn anything from animation, marketing, entrepreneurship, and a lot more, an annual membership on Skillshare costs less than $10. So if you go to the link in the description below, you'll get 2 months of access to those classes completely free. So start learning today by going to skl.sh/CaptainMidnight25. That's skl.sh/CaptainMidnight25.
Here's a special tip for the fellas and girls who have not already joined Captain Midnight's new 1940 Flight Patrol. You'd better hurry up and join at once, because there's a big adventure ahead. The thing to do now is to get started, because we're going to have not only barrels of fun, but loads of free gifts and prizes too.